friends, callers, is all being. This imploding vacuum personality is void of any self. The Blessed Buddha explained this passing transience of existence as void like this. Suppose a man with good sight observed the many bubbles in the Ganges River as it drifted along. Then, by carefully watching and examining them all, then, after he had carefully examined them, they would appear to him empty, evanescent, void and unsubstantial. In exactly the same way does a bhikkhu observe all material phenomena, all feelings, all perceptions, all mental constructions and all states of consciousness, whether they be past, present or future, far or near, as bubbles, by carefully watching, analyzing and examining them all, they appear to him as empty, void, without any core. Regarding these impersonal processes, any action is without an actor, neither agent nor actor exists, only egoless acting processes unfolds. Ask not who, but what. Who feels? Nobody feels. What feels? Feeling itself feels. What does feeling feel? Feeling feels pain, pleasure, and neutral indifference. Who perceives? Nobody perceives. What perceives then? Perception itself perceives. What does perception perceive? Perception perceives, receives, records, forms, colors, sounds, smells, tastes, touches, ideas, thoughts, and mental states. Who recognizes? Nobody cognizes. What then cognizes? Consciousness itself cognizes. What does consciousness recognize? Consciousness cognizes feelings, perceived experiences, and all the other various mental states as joys, anger, jealousy, generosity, and so forth. These imprints arise and cease incessantly. Observable is this. This auditory consciousness that you're hearing this with arise and cease right there. With the end of this word, no lasting same self can ever reside or remain within this fleeting transience. In this passing flux of discrete mental states, exactly like when the single still pictures of a rolling film momentarily passes in between the lens and the lamp, causing a blinking projection to appear as real, or here, or there, on the screen of consciousness. Then neither a feeler, nor an experiencer, nor an observing agent can be found, assumed, constructed, concluded, or deposited. No one is in or behind, neither the film nor the mental projection. Just this blinking projection itself is, and that only for a very short moment. Just like we cannot conclude from the two facts that there is a cinema, and there's a film projected inside this cinema, we cannot conclude that there actually are anybody inside the cinema. As the external town, city, cinema very well may be all empty of any audience. Similar with this internal seminar of mere experience of consciousness is also empty of any self, empty of any person, empty of any soul, empty of any entity, empty of any observer, apart from the projected passing experience itself. Where actually is this ego, this adored yet imaginary self then hiding? Is the self identical with the body? No. Is the self hidden inside the body? No. Is the self outside or apart from the body? No. Does the self own and possess a body? No. Does the body own and possess a self? No. There's just this frame of a body, but no self as controller of it. Is the self identical with the feeling? No. Is the self hidden inside the feeling? No. Is the self outside and apart from the feeling? No. Does the self own and possess a feeling? No. Does the feeling own and possess a self? No. There's just this sensation of feeling, but no self as a feeler. Is the self identical with the perception, the experience? No. Is the self hidden inside the perceived experience? No. Is the self then outside and apart from the perceived experience? No. Does the self own and possess a perceived experience? No. Does the experience own and possess a self then? No. There's just this moment of experience, a moment of perception, but no self as experiencer or observer. Is the self identical with the mental construction? No. Is the self hidden inside the mental constructions? No. Is the self outside apart from the mental construction? No. Does the self own and possess mental construction? No. Does the mental construction own and possess a self then? No. There's just this activity of mental construction. But there's no self as a constructor. Is the self then identical with consciousness? No. Is the self hidden inside the consciousness? No. Is the self outside, apart from consciousness? No. Does the self own and possess a consciousness? No. Does the consciousness own and possess a self? No. There's just these fleeting moments of aware consciousness, but no self being conscious inside there. Why not? Because all these phenomena arise, change and cease. If the proposition of a self is taken as confirmed, then one should say, this identical, same and unchanging self should arise, change and cease in every moment, which is absurd, contradictory and inconsistent with any concept which we identify with as myself. How can a so-called same self arise as new and cease in each moment? If the self is not the same, it is then changed into another self. Any self who is another self is clearly an inconsistent, absurd fantasy. Is the self then a collective conglomerate of body, feeling, experience and consciousness? No. Why not? If the self is not found within any of the parts, it cannot either be found within any collections of the very same parts. In conclusion, all egoism is based on an assumed and long cherished and reinforced idea of an agent inside, labeled as the self, which does not exist except as an idea, a mental construction, which beings fall in love with and violently defend. This auto-romance has taken place in all the prior rebirths, also when animal or insect or deva. So it's a long reinforced bad habit. The ego is a really bad habit because it's a falsehood that is more than fatal. Why so? Because it drags beings back into rebirth and thus repeated death. This assumed, non-existent, hypothetical, self-agent identity, soul, or personality does not exist as an unchanging entity or reality. Freed of such self-possession, freed of such self-obsession, one is freed of the first hindrance, blocking stream entry, namely personality belief, sakkaya-ditti. Buddha once said, "Blissful is solitude for one who's content, learned, and who sees the true Dhamma. Blissful is harmlessness towards all beings without exception. Blissful is freedom from any sensual urge whatsoever. Yet the supreme bliss is the elimination, this abysmal self-deception I am." Dana, Inspiration 2.1. This, the Buddhist doctrine of no self, is called anatta. The best way to comprehend no self is to begin with observing and reflecting on impermanence, anicca, and suffering, dukkha. Then eventually one comes to understand whatever is always otherwise and never the same, never identical with itself, cannot ever be an identity, the same self. What is always, ultimately speaking, suffering, cannot be under control of a self. Since if it were, then the self would, by this control, change it into something pleasant and happy. But no self can do that, since it is not, apparently, in full control. If the self is not in control of even itself, what is then in control? Can it then be a self if it's not in control of itself, if it has no autonomy? No. It is just conditions that plays out their cause and effects. May all come to see that and be calmed and released. Thereby, it's subtle, it's complicated, yet it is true and freeing. Ownerlessness is a universal characteristic of all being. Impersonal are all states and phenomena, without a core, void of self and substance. If one feels a bit dizzy, or maybe slight fear, when rigorously attempting to comprehend egolessness, then one is going in the right direction. Keep digging there. Worth noticing it is one can never lose a self that never was there in the first place. That never was there in the first place. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. This is indeed Dhamma on Air number 79, recorded on the 29th September, the year 2017. On the Cypress Hermitage, on a windy day, with clear light all over the place, and fresh, cool mountain air. On Nagas Mountain, central hill country, Sri Lanka, as you see here. There are one concept and three questions. But first, the normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. First off the bat, remember to click subscribe and the small bell down there This is more literally than you think, your ticket to Nirvana. Instead of taking a Buddhist similes, then I this time taking a Buddhist concept, and I'll start to do that, spray them in between, because there's many Buddhist concepts that panyatis that we should learn from early Buddhist philosophy. This is a Buddhist concept of Viveka in Pali, and it means seclusion. Somebody also translated it detachment or solitariness, but actually seclusion captures the meaning best. It means that one is isolated from, secluded from, apart from, outside from, external to, and thereby protected from various disadvantageous states. There are three kinds. There's bodily seclusion, kaya viveka. This means that one is secluded from all kinds of temptations and aversions and things that arise doubt and uncertainty, like, for example, advertisements, being in the city among other people, being constantly bombarded with all kinds of sense stimuli and attractions and aversions in the city. So, this bodily seclusion is an external seclusion. When it's external seclusion, like when you go into the forest, or when you go to your small house outside, or whatever meditation hut you have, or a boat can also be, wherever you can be alone and secluded from all these problematic issues of attractions and aversions. So this is dwelling in solitude, free from alluring sense objects and aversive or opposing or repulsive objects, phenomena and states. Then there's number two is mental seclusion, citta viveka. It's something internal. It's basically that one is internally secluded, apart from, protected from all kinds of desire, lust, attraction, all kinds of aversion, anger, hate, all kinds of ignorance, doubt, uncertainty, speculation and worries. Basically, it means that one is apart from, secluded from, external from, protected from the five mental hindrances. So, citta viveka means that one is secluded from sense desire, kamachanda. One is secluded from all kinds of aversion and hate. One is secluded and isolated and protected from all kinds of dullness, lethargy and laziness. Tina mitta. One is secluded from restlessness and remorse, all kinds of agitation and worries, anxiety. And one is secluded from doubt, uncertainty, skepsis, hesitation, confusion. Secluded from that, one can enter the first jhana. Because one has to be secluded from the five mental hindrances, the nivaranas, in order to enter the first jhana. And also in order to attain happiness, actually. Even momentary happiness, right here and now, is dependent upon this seclusion, this viveka, this peace. Then there's the third kind is ultimative seclusion. It's seclusion from all substrata of existence. Upadhi viveka means secluded from any kind of clinging. Any kind of clinging to the world, any kind of clinging to the body, any kind of clinging to the identity. I am this and that. I'm this and that person, this and that social class, this and that education. I'm this and that nationality. And also cling to the world in general with all its alluring and repulsive objects. This basically means it's a synonym of Nibbana, because there's no other place you can be secluded from the world and be secluded from the dangers and suffering that is inherent and imminent in contact with the world, with samsara. So if one stops clinging to what is suffering, starts clinging to samsara, relinquishes all the world and all forms of existence, then one has secluded oneself from all kind of clinging and attained this last, ultimate speaking, highest kind of seclusion of Viveka, upadhi Viveka. There's also something else connected with this. This is Viveka Sukha. It's the happiness, the satisfaction connected with being secluded. Connected with being Kaya Viveka, secluded by the body outside the city. Like I enjoy every day, especially today when it's so nice weather. Being out in nature. Not being caught up in a traffic jam. Or in a workplace. Or whatever. Not being caught up, but being secluded by being one by oneself. Secluded from advertisement, secluded from sellers, commercial activities of all kinds, secluded from any alluring, tempting objects, secluded from any repulsive object. Then it's easy to attain the state where there's no like, nor is there any dislike. Easy, easy. Then one experiences happiness of seclusion. Viveka Sukha. It's a kind of detached aloofness where one is staying above. It's like hovering above all this phenomena of samsara that is going on, is bustling around. There's political fights and all kinds of things. Sports and politics and culture. All kinds of conflicts and directions and meanings. And it's a one big cacophony. Down here at the human society, then one stays aloof there, looks down, detached, not involved with, not a part of all this buzz, all this fight, all this suffering, all this urge for this and that, craving for this and that, fight about this and that, forms of sense pleasure. Whosoever is addicted to society and worldly bustle, he will not partake of the happiness of renunciation, of the happiness of seclusion, of the happiness of detachment. He will not partake of peace and enlightenment, said the Buddha. Anguttara, Book of 5, Sutta 86. Viveka Sukha, the happiness of seclusion, which I can recommend from the deepest of my heart. It is basically comes basically from the logical fact, if you cling to what is suffering, then you cannot be secluded from it. Then you are together with suffering. Then you will suffer. While you, if you detach from it, say, okay, let it go, wherever I want to go, then you become secluded from it, protected from it, apart from it, isolated from it, outside it, and thereby you experience no suffering. They once asked a bhikkhu named Elder, or Senior, was his only name, Elder. How venerable Elder is one living completely secluded? Regarding this, this Elder responded, all that is past, this one has left all behind. All that is future, this one has all relinquished. And all that is present now, this one has completely removed any desire and lust for. The intelligent one who has conquered all, who understands all phenomena, who are from all things, phenomena and states detached, disengaged and unsoiled, who has given up all, released by the irreversible removal of craving, such one I call living secluded. So, having left all that is past behind, this means all memories, all what happened in your youth, all your childhood, all stories from the past of parents, of parenting, and so on. All that is past, this one has to link, is one is not part of it. One is not clinging to one's past. And all dreaming, all conjuring up, hoping for any particular future, this and that, may I be like this and that, may I have this and that, this is what this has one relinquished. One doesn't buzz around with it. So now we only have the present. The past has been cut off, and the future has also been relinquished. It's released. Now there's only the present. If you don't urge for that, crave for that, have sense desire and lust for that, then there's complete detachment. There's this aloofness, aboveness, looking down upon, hovering above all these problems, about all these issues. This word you use, unsoiled, it's worth to remember, because any contact with samsara, any contact with society, any contact with any world, whether divine or human or animal or whatever, this accumulates mental defilements, either desire or aversion or ignorance, doubt and uncertainty. So it is like the Buddha, he said one time to one who comes and asks him how come he was a Buddha, then he said, it's like a lovely white lotus, perfect white lotus. It grows in muddy water, but it's unsoiled by this water it grows in. And I'm unsoiled with the world I have arisen. Therefore, I'm the Buddha. So this is another aspect of samsara. If you are in samsara, then you get dirty hands, inherently. You get dirty mind, inherently. You get blood on your hands, inherently. You get blood on your mind and in your future, inherently. If not extremely careful. Because it's so easy to make mistakes in samsara. There's so many tempting, tantalizing objects. There's so many repulsive objects. How not to react with like and dislike? With lust, greed, with aversion and hate. It's very difficult. You're bombarded with this sense stimuli all the time. External objects, internal objects as well, one's own thoughts, dreaming, hating, opposing, speculating, worrying about, being anxious about, doubting, and so on. There's this kind of Buddhahood that's called Pachika Buddha, solitary Buddhas. They live alone, they live at least very secluded. And they have some poems called the solitary, like the rhinoceros horn. It's a one-horn rhinoceros. And these rhinoceroses, they all live alone. They go around alone. And they have a lesson to teach us, these rhinoceros. Here's one of their poems. These Pachika Buddhas have some verses. It's a part of the Sutta Nipata, which you see here, just retranslated by Bhikkhu Bodhi with the commentary. I can recommend it. And the poet goes like this. It's Sutta Nipata 50 to 52. Since sensual pleasures, variegated, sweet and delightful, agitate the mind with their varied forms, thus seeing danger in the streams of sense pleasure, one should wander alone, solitary, secluded as a rhinoceros horn. This for me is a calamity, a tumor, a setback, a disease, a barb, a danger. Seeing the vulnerability in the pitfall of these five strands of sense pleasure, seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, and touching, one should wander mentally secluded and reclusive as a rhinoceros horn. Cold, heat, hunger, thirst, wind, scorching sun, gadflies and snakes, having endured all these adversities patiently, one should wander alone, withdrawn, as an imperturbable, undisturbable rhinoceros horn. This is the Indian rhinoceros, Unicornis, has only one horn. I don't think there's anyone left of them anymore, actually. They're extinct. Before we go to the questions, I just say I have two Dhamma drops on whatbuddhasaid.net. I give the links below. On sense seclusion, on Viveka, and you can follow up there. The question 232 goes like this: how does one repair past bad deeds? And question B is past karma unavoidable and modifiable? Karma is not unavoidable, it's not destiny. It's not locked. It's continuously probabilities that can be modified that are going up and down. Let's say you have some bad karma because of greed. For example, having sex with a illegitimate partner, somebody else's partner. Then if you do it again, this probability goes up and up. If you stop doing it and start recommending not doing it, then this karma goes down. So it's continually modified and added to. So one can modify. How to repair bad deeds? If one can repair, if one has told a lie, then go back to the person one has told a lie and say, I'm sorry, I told you this and that, it was not true, can you forgive me? This takes courage, but it's worth doing. And one will experience a relief already at the decision of doing it. Or if one has stolen something, go back to the person or organization or whatever, the shop where they're stolen, and then give it back and say, I'm sorry, can you forgive me? This is repairing. Let's say so one cannot identify those who have been hurt or betrayed or have had bad experiences with one's evil deeds because of one's evil deeds, wrong behavior, ethical awkwardness. Then one should do good deeds that is directed specifically towards this object. If one has killed somebody or something, animals for example, then one should give something that gives life. Give donations to animal hospitals or animal caretakers or animal medical units or hospitals in general or anything that promotes health and give life to others. One has taken life, now one gives life. Then one modifies the bad down to, well, doing something good down to zero. That's the ideal case. Let's say one person who has been a soldier in a former life, he shot an enemy, but then in the next life he built 10 hospitals. Then he might still feel the karma as a mosquito bite. But he doesn't know it's because of having killed this other person in a former life or as a soldier. So all karma is modifiable. And it's worth to remember that one of the Buddha's pupil, Angulimala, he has a chain of fingers, chopped off fingers around his neck, 999 fingers, because he's been told by his teacher to kill 919,000 people actually. And the day he was about to kill his mother, then the Buddha rescued him and took him to the monastery and made a monk out of him. And he became an arahant after having paid back a lot of suffering to the families of those who he killed, because when he went Pindabad there with his begging bowl, then they threw stone at him and beat him with a stick. Eventually he gave life to helped a woman who was giving birth, but the baby could not come out. Then assisted in that, in getting medicine, the right medicine for that situation. And thereby he became an arahant. So all karma can be modified, but one has to do a significant effort for it. Since we don't know, in most cases, what karma there is in our past, this can only an enlightened person know. And since we're not enlightened yet, then we don't know it usually. Then we should do good as acute as our hair was in flames. This is the only thing that makes sense in this life. It is to prevent downfall and then create elevation in the future. Improve one situation to go forth. Improve one situation to withdraw, go out of society. And gain significant and sufficient freedom to attain enlightenment. This one can only do by paying back the debt, the karmic debt one has, until they are leveled out to a zero. Everybody has to do that. Mahamogayana, the left-hand disciple of the Buddha, usually have his figures with blue skin. You see some images of him here. He had killed in a former life, killed his mother and father. And therefore, by beating them up with a club, and therefore in his last life, he was clubbed to death. So it just means that you have to pay back what you earned, what you paid up, accumulated in evil deeds. So first, of course, is to stop doing more evil. Stop accumulating more evil, and then to repay the evil so it comes up to zero by doing good. And since one doesn't know how much negative one has to do as much as positive one possibly can. When coming close to zero, one will feel it. How is it felt subjectively? As innocence, as the joy and lightness and freed situation of the mind that is innocent. It's not bugged by anything, some past memories, subconscious memories of doing evil, some regrets. It's free of regret and remorse. When it's free of regret and remorse, there's no anxiety, no worries, no speculation. There's only this lightness of the mind, this adaptability, that it can do whatever it likes, easily, effortlessly, because it's getting rid of all this past bad karma that was weighing it down as a heavy carpet, or like running around with a rucksack full of stones. Another feeling is like a black stone falling from the heart, falling out of the heart. When one gives up all this grudge towards other persons, or this bad karma, it's like a stone falling from the heart. Very nice, very relieving. So it's a relief, an elevating relief to be free from one's bad karma, having repaired it or modified it by doing something compensatory good to a significant degree. If you can find a noble person, because says if you do good to a dog, then it'll come back thousands of times. If you do good to a human, roughly a million times. But if you do good to a noble person, an Arya, then it will come back incalculable times. Incalculable means cannot be expressed by numbers. Not infinite, but close to, as close as infinite you can come. If you do it to a Sammasambuddha, then it's incalculable, times incalculable, seven times. So it's incalculable, as Sankhya, to the seventh degree. And therefore it can last many universes. Therefore it repairs also what you have done bad many universes back. But since there's no Sammasambuddha here, you'll have to find a noble. It might be more simple than you think. So, how does one repair past deeds? By doing good. And specifically, if one can repair it, seeking of the persons that have been hurt, and then give back or apologize for what one has done. Is past karma unavoidable? No, it is modifiable. Modifiable. And that's our chance. Otherwise, it is unavoidable. If we don't repair it, then we'll have to suffer from this bad karma, this bad behavior, this disharmony we created in the universe. We'll have to experience this as internal, own disharmony. Question 233. Pleasure when eating or breathing fresh air is healthy. So is this sense, it's not good to seek what is pleasant? Yes and no. Of course, healthy when you breathe air and so on and eat food can be healthy, but can also be unhealthy. But nevertheless, it's addictive to feel any kind of sense pleasure. So it basically means that if you breathe a lot of fresh air like today, fresh mountain air, and eat a lot of good vegetarian food, and it's so delicious, well, then one becomes addicted to that. This means that one creates a clinging in the mind that will persist in the death moment. This means then one will be reborn somewhere according to one's karma with a higher low, where one will try to seek back to fresh air and good food again. When one has been reborn, there will be more aging, sickness and death, and thereby more suffering. So by this addiction, one is stacking up future suffering down the lane. So because one is stacking up this future suffering down the lane, one accumulates more of it. So therefore, it's not advantageous to take delight in sense pleasure, even in fresh air and vegetarian food. You should just be aware of it. I'm partaking of this air and this food in order to maintain myself blamelessly, And I will use that to approach Nibbana, the final end of suffering. Not for any other purpose than that. So no sense pleasure is by any means innocent or advantageous. Even the pleasure of jhana meditation, you can be addicted to. That can also be a block on the road, because then you will hang on there in this jhana. You will hang on the Brahma level, basically. Brahma level is level 13 upwards towards 27. So you have to go beyond level 31 to be enlightened. So any kind of clinging, any kind of clinging caused by this, taking delight, accepting, welcoming, and saying, ah, it has a price. Question 234. If feeling extreme anxiety and fear about the body's health and aging, how must the disciple of the Buddha face these unpleasant realities of life? This is fear. This is fear of aging and fear of sickness. There's a very good cure. It's very radical. It's not so much spoken about today, but I hope I'll make good for that. It's Asubha meditation, corpse meditation, recommended also by the Buddha. Either one, make it. Meditate on one's own skeletons, or skeletons in general, one's own corpse or corpses in general, then one will gain fearlessness of death. One doesn't fear lose the body. I did some in my early stages, a lot of skeleton meditation, but also some meditation where I invited other people's imaginary people to cut myself in slices this way with razor blade slabs, sharps, huh? Like samurai swords. And then after this way, then that way, chup, and cutting the face, for example, or cutting the genitals where you feel most clinging to, can be the most relieving also. Because if you can do that, invite people to chop you up or burn you, or seeing this rotting corpse, seeing your own body rotting, full of maggots, then you have no fear. Then you realize that this body is a prison. Why become anxious and have fear about losing a prison? That's not rational. There will always be another side, on the other side of this body. There will be another body. What kind of this body will be? Yes, there will be a divine body if one do sufficiently good. Divine bodies don't decay. There's no aging and sickness there. There is death. Yes, that's true. Devas, even on the first one level up, they only decay to the extent that just before their death, after they have lived in a minimum of 50 million years, that's the minimum. Most live more than that. But 50 million years, they will see their clothes starting to be disordered. Their flowers that hang on their neck, they start to be withering. They'll have sweat coming out from their armpits. And they doesn't feel satisfied by sitting in the divine seat that they sit in. And when this happened, then the other devas recognized, now he's close to death. But they still look the same. Their body still look the same. There's no physical diseases, like heart disease, cancer, and so on. Dementia doesn't exist on the divine level. So if this is a prison, then we are in prison on here on planet Earth. Why be so bothered about it? This fearlessness of death is extreme relief, because if you don't fear death, then you don't fear anything, actually. You might be aversive to it still, but it's not fear, it's hate. But you don't fear it. There's no anxiety, no worries. And this fearlessness of death can be achieved by this method. As the best Buddha said, if a monk sees a corpse, 1 day, 2 days, 3 days dead, swollen, blue, festering, thrown into the cemetery, he uses this experience regarding his own body. Verily, exactly so is also my own body. It is of the same nature. Just so will this body become disgusting, and it will never, and can never escape this fate. If a monk sees a body thrown into the cemetery, beaten, eaten by crows, hawks, vultures, dogs, jackals, or by a variety of worms and maggots, if a monk sees a corpse reduced to a skeleton with some flesh and blood still attached to it and held together by sinews, if a monk sees a cadaver, a blood-smeared skeleton, but without any flesh, held together by tendons as a chain of bones, if a monk sees a carcass, just a skeleton with any flesh and blood, just still held together by tendons, if a monk sees a skeleton separated bones, scattered in a mess, here a hand bone, there a foot bone, there the pelvis, there the spine, there the skull, if a monk sees a skeleton simple as a bleached white shell-like bones, if a monk sees bare bones thrown into the cemetery lying heaped up, if a monk sees a stack of bones now gone rotten and turning into dust, he then applies this experience to his own body. Verily and exactly so is also my own body. It is of the same nature, so fragile and feeble it is. It will inevitably turn into dust and can never or will ever escape this fate. If he can't do that, then he lives fearless, detached, and cling to nothing in this world. When I did skill meditation, I still do regularly, but one nice feature I did, when my skeleton was reduced to dust, I see it on a cliff surface, and I do like it, blow away the dust. When you can blow away the dust of your own skeleton without feeling sorrow of it, having been reduced to dust first in the first place, but then you blow away this also, then there's release. Then there's fearlessness. Of course, huh? At Savatthi, the blessed Buddha said, because when the perception of a human skeleton or a worm-infested bleeding or a pus-festering corpse or a livid bluish black and rottening corpse or a cut-up, gnawed and hacked corpse or a bloated, inflated and swollen corpse is developed and cultivated, then it is of great fruit. Then it is of great advantage. Then it is of great benefit. It leads to great good. It leads to great security from bondage. It leads to a great sense of urgency, samvega. It leads to living in the fearless ease of comfort. It leads to the fearless ease of comfort. Fearlessness, in other words, fearless ease. The best Buddha once said, furthermore, bhikkhus and friends, if seeing a corpse thrown into the grave, which is 1, 2, or 3 days dead, swollen, bloated, bluish black, full of filth, one should draw this conclusion regarding one's own body. This body too has its nature, has its destiny, and cannot escape it. If one should see a corpse thrown into the burial ground, gnawed, partly eaten by crows, hawks, vultures, dogs, or jackals, creeping with all kinds of worms and maggots, one should draw this conclusion regarding one's own body. This body too has this nature, become exactly like that and cannot ever escape it. If one should see a chain of bones, flesh hanging from it, splattered with blood, held together by the sinews, or bones disconnected and scattered in all directions, here a hand bone, there a foot bone, here the pelvis, the spine, the skull, or bones now bleached, pale, white, and looking like seashells, or black, rotten bones finally crumpling into dust, one should think, this body too has this destiny. It cannot escape it. So it's Majjhima Nikaya number 10 and Digha Nikaya number 22. Which object are suitable for who? A swollen corpse is those who lust for beauty after form. A discolored corpse is those who lust after the beauty of the skin and complexion. A festering corpse is those who lust after a sweet smelling, using perfumes, body. A fissured corpse is those who lust after firmness of the breast and solidity of the body. A mangled corpse is also after fullness of the flesh, such as the breast. A dismembered corpse is those who lust after graceful movements of the bodies, who like ballet or dancing like that. A cut and dismembered corpse is for those who lust after the perfection of the joints. A bloodstained corpse is those who lust after beauty produced by adornments, like clothes and jewelry. A worm-infested corpse is those who attach to the idea that the body is me or mine. A skeleton is those who lost after perfection of the teeth and the nails. Morris's corpse meditation says Asubha-Bhavana. See what buddhaset.net drops three, the 32 parts, the skeleton corpse meditation and the nine corpse meditations. I give the links below. I also made an audio, a guided Asubha meditation on my SoundCloud profile. I give the link below, the 32 parts and the nine corpses audio. And the source text is Majjhima Nikaya number 119, the Kayagata-Sati, the mindfulness, awareness going to the body. I give the link below. Lastly is to say thank you to all the supporters, Dayakas, seers, receivers, friends and donors, especially those two persons who recently donated. Is a person from Bronx, New York, a family man with several daughters. He gave the website cost for 1 year, and because he did that, he will partake of the merit that is pumping out from a website, whatbuddhaset.net, which pumps out 6.5 gigabytes every day of Dhamma to all over the world. The three largest users is USA, China and India. So because he have paid the cost for that, he will partake of this immense pumping out of Dhamma, spreading, sharing Dhamma in all over the world every day, 6 gigabytes. And there also one person, also from New York, from USA, who gave the an updating of the video editing software I used to edit this video with, and I also thank him. And to all those who given me cost for cameras, microphones, sound recording equipment that you cannot see, everything that is behind the scene and out of frame for this video production, I'd also like to thank them especially. Much merit to them all. Secondly, I'd like to thank those who gave food the last time. Much merit to them also. Lastly, but not least, have a nice and noble day. Namo Tassa. Bhagavato. Arahato. Samma sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Indeed. Good luck with your Viveka, with your seclusion. Seclusion of the body, being alone, in fresh air outside. Seclusion from sense desires, advertisement, buzz of the city. To finally attain this seclusion from all substrata of existence, Nirvana. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. As the next Buddha, the noble Arya Ajitamitaya will say, you can come as you like, but you pay as you go. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.